Well, good morning, everybody. Thank you. I want to certainly thank B. Mitchell King, my cousin from the same plantation. Y'all will catch that later. And the Georgia Power Company for supporting us in this endeavor. We started on this journey last year with the race back to the truth, the lies, and the myths. And obviously, in light of our climate, we must continue these kinds of discussions. And I feel that as the embodiment institutionally of Dr. King's legacy, we first and foremost have a responsibility to be a part of and probably at some point at the forefront of discussions like this. And so we thank you for your support, your input into all of this, and we will begin. So I want to welcome you to our second annual King Holiday Observance and Love Community Talk. In tandem with the 30th anniversary of the Martin Luther King Jr. Holiday Observance, this year we are commemorating the 87th birthday, what would have been the 87th birthday of my father, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And we believe that one of the fitting ways to obviously do this is in a way in keeping with the vision of my mother, as well as the current vision of the King Center, by hosting conversations for building what my father called the beloved community. The race fact and rights versus responsibilities are two such conversations, and are reflective of what we call now Nonviolence 365, which is our education and training based on my father's nonviolent philosophy. Historically, we have called this Kingian nonviolence, obviously out of my father's name. But I felt it apropos to call it Nonviolence 365, especially in today's time, so that people understand that it is more than a mere tactic or strategy, but that it's really about a 365 day of the year philosophy. It's a way of life, in other words. Our education and training, based off of my father's philosophy, subscribes to nonviolence, as I said, as a lifestyle to be lived every day. As we commemorate his birthday, we also commemorate his philosophy and consider how nonviolence should permeate all areas of our lives, including our conversation. 60 years ago, we celebrated the birth of Nonviolence 365 with the birth of the Montgomery bus boycott. And so as we look to this year, we've decided to capture it in the theme, Remember, Celebrate, Act, King's Legacy of Freedom for Our World. This theme commemorates my father's work during the Chicago Freedom Movement, which took place 50 years ago. At that point, he was waging a nonviolent movement to advance economic justice for poor blacks in Chicago slums, specifically attacking the injustices in housing and talking about fair and open housing. Inequity and racial disparities in housing, as we know, are still issues in this nation. In this area and many others, race is still a factor, and we have yet to fulfill our responsibilities to each other, to work together to ensure that we are living in a just and humane society. Further, we struggle to talk about these issues, especially in a real way, and sometimes refuse to do so constructively, respectfully. But why is this? And I want you to hear this. In my father's first book that detailed the Montgomery campaign, Stride Toward Freedom, I encourage you to get that book. My mother used to always tell people, if you want to study Dr. King, go to the source first. And I want to say that especially for those that are a bit younger than myself. I'm still kind of young. But it's always important to go to the primary source before you go to a secondary source, so that you have the foundation as you approach all of these other critiques or those who profess to be interpreting that particular person's life or legacy. And so in Stride Toward Freedom, I believe he provided some insight to this why. He wrote, men often hate each other because they fear each other. They fear each other because they don't know each other. And they don't know each other because they cannot communicate. And they cannot communicate because they are separated. I want to say that one more time. Men, and I will add women so that some of us won't get offended. He was writing in his context, but I don't think he meant merely men. Men often hate each other because they fear each other. They fear each other because they don't know each other. They don't know each other because they cannot communicate with each other. They cannot communicate because they are separated. I believe these words ring true today, and they reflect a cycle that is increasingly detrimental to society. We're not communicating because we're separated in our silos, in our own cultural worlds. We're separated because we don't see our interconnectedness as humanity, and because we focus on our differences instead of our commonalities. And that is all rooted in a fear that prevents us from knowing each other. One of my father's favorite quotes is that we are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality. That means you can't orbit out of here. You can't fly out of here. There's nothing you can do. We're caught inescapably in a network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. And what affects one directly affects all indirectly. And I can't be all that I ought to be until you are all that you ought to be. And you cannot be all that you ought to be until I am all that I ought to be. So today, this is a nonviolent conversation. Look at your neighbor and say, nonviolent conversation. Nonviolent. Nonviolent. You know that. It is needed, and don't think that because it's nonviolent, it means that you have to mince your words. Truth is the order of the day, and because we cannot get there if we don't speak in that vein. So it's needed. It's needed in our families, in our workplaces, in our classrooms, in our entertainment industry, Nancy, in our public policy discussions, our political campaigns, Mr. Trump, in the media, in our social media engagement, and it's needed here today. None of us can escape. We all, at some point or another, may have been guilty of not engaging in nonviolent conversation. And it doesn't always mean just what you say. It can also reflect how you deal with that person attitudinally in conversation. And so, there is power in this type of conversation. Both of my parents demonstrated that power in their approach to difficult, pressing issues. Their goal was social change, and they had an abiding commitment to love, believing that it will have the final say. I believe one of the things that my mother modeled the best was this whole notion of forgiveness. When you harbor unforgiveness toward anybody, regardless of what they have done, it puts you in a position where it's difficult to engage them in any kind of nonviolent way. And so I recall growing up with a mom who would always say, "I don't hold grudges." And you can imagine she had every reason to hold all kinds of grudges. As a wife who oftentimes had to spend most of the time looking after us, and women, sometimes, you know, we can be very needy, and we can be very nagging, which she was not. And so she had every reason in that way. She was the one that was in the home when it was bombed in 1956, not my father. My father did not face that first, not just threat, but the manifestation of it. It was Coretta Scott King. She had every reason, living constantly under the threat of death, to be resentful and hateful. She had every reason, when her husband was assassinated, to hate. But but she chose to love and forgive. So that's for somebody here today. This belief is foundational to nonviolent communication. Understanding where we should levy our attack is also essential to nonviolent conversation. My father's third principle of nonviolence 365 is that nonviolence seeks to direct the attack against the forces of evil, the injustice, the wrongdoing, rather than against the person who happens to be doing evil or wrong or injustice. Simply put, nonviolence attacks issues and not people and their personhood. Issue awareness and focus adds to the power of the communication. Its goal is not to destroy or dehumanize people, but to increase consciousness and help to reconcile and ensure freedom and justice. We are here today with respectful, as I said earlier, truthful, genuine conversation, nonviolent conversation, to discuss the race factor and rights versus responsibilities. We must have discipline for these conversations. For as my mother stated, nonviolence is a spiritual discipline that requires a great deal of strength, growth, and purging of oneself. So let's talk. Let's grow together. Let's share truth while respecting each other's humanity. Let's act on what we learn. Let's build the beloved community with Nonviolence 365. I want to now introduce a moderator for today from Fox 5 Atlanta, a wonderful anchor there, Ms. Deirdre Dukes.
Good morning.